Namaste and greetings. I, Karnika Arun, researcher at IMPRI, Impact and Policy Research Institute, Prabhav Evam Niti Anusandhan Samsthan, Nayi Dilli, extend my warmest welcome to you all to IMPRI hashtag Web Policy Talk. Today, we are gathered for an in memoriam and a book discussion on Reimagining Sociology in India, Feminist Perspectives. In the memory of Sharmila Rege. This deliberation is organized by the IMPRI Gender Impact Studies Center, GISC. As the chair for the session, we have Professor Vibhuti Patel, Visiting Distinguished Professor at IMPRI and GISC, former Professor, Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai. We welcome you, ma'am. With the permission of chair, I would like to introduce the gathering.
Yes, Kanika, please go ahead and introduce the panelists. Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am. We are elated to welcome the editors of the book, Reimagining Sociology in India, Feminist Perspectives, Professor Dr. Gita Chadha, Department of Sociology, University of Mumbai, Dr. Joseph M.T., Department of Sociology, University of Mumbai. We are also elated to invite the esteemed panelists. We'd like to welcome Dr. Anagha Tambe, Director and Assistant Professor, KSP Women's Studies Center, Savitribai Phule, Pune University. Professor Sanjay Srivastava, British Academy Global Professor, Department of Anthropology and Sociology, SOAS University of London. Dr. Smita Patil, Assistant Professor, School of Gender and Development Studies, Indira Gandhi National Open University, New Delhi. A very warm welcome to all of you. Now, I invite our chair, Professor Vibhuti Patel, to initiate the deliberation with her opening remarks, invite our esteemed panelists, and proceed further. We look forward to learning from the esteemed gathering. Thank you.
Thank you, Karnika. First of all, I would like to express my heartfelt thanks to IMPRI team, Dr. Arjun Kumar, Dr. Simi Mehta, and team for today's preparation. I know there is a massive response on all YouTube, Facebook Live, and Zoom. There are many expectations from today's panel book discussion. And I greet Dr. Gita Chadha, Dr. Joseph, Dr. Anagha Tambe, Dr. Smita Patil and Dr. Srivastava for joining the panel as a panelist for the book discussion. I would like to begin with the quote from Pierre Bourdieu, French sociologist and public intellectual, and I quote, "The function of sociology, as of every science, is to reveal that which is hidden. And I know this book has done the same task of revealing what was hidden, bringing the gender analysis, bringing the gender and gender lens in the sociological researches, knowledge and knowledge construction. In the knowledge production mission that is gender sensitive, gender responsive, I think in this exercise, the book makes a landmark contribution in terms of going into the making of feminist sociologists, the four mothers who did the pioneering work. The introduction has set the tone. It's introduction by both Dr. Gita Chadha and Dr. M.T. Joseph has provided the framework. They have gone, the first section talks about the early women sociologists with special focus on Dr. Neera Desai, Dr. Parvatamma, and Dr. Ratna Naidu. I have met two of them. I worked closely with Neera Desai and Dr. Parvatamma, yes, in Mysore University, we have met. In the second section of pedagogies and mentoring, I think it brings out the second generation of feminist sociologists and Anurekha Chari, Lina Pujari, Ashika Bhargav, Riya De Silva, Rukmini Sen, Pushpesh Kumar, Vishal Jadhav, and Manisha Rao. They have Patadat and Rini Thomas. They have made excellent contribution. I would like to provide the historical background of resurgence of feminism in sociology as a discipline which responded the first when the feminist knowledge construction began in our country. Towards Equality Report tabled in the Parliament of India brought landmark contribution made by feminist sociologists such as Dr. Neera Desai and Professor Leela Dubey. Their contributions for the first time got official recognition. For them, social theories were as important as praxis. In 1975, when ICSSR gave mandate to focus social sciences researches on women's work in different sectors of economy, feminist sociologists and feminist economists worked in unison. Triangulation of quantitative and qualitative data took place. Mainstream sociology, anthropology, ethnography had to open up to the critical consciousness provided by feminists that gave primacy to women's experiences. Influence of feminist sociologists was also found in a Shramashakti report, which came out in 1988, that captured insights into labor processes of women in the unorganized sector and self-employed women who are at the bottom of the pyramid of poverty. The next generation of feminist sociologists made stellar contribution. One of them was Professor Sharmila Rege, who died young at the age of 49 on this particular day, 13 July. It coincides today, at least, with the Guru Purnima. Sharmila's scholarly contribution was prolific. She was extremely popular as a teacher with massive fan following, humane in personal conduct. For 10 years, from 1992 and 2002, I did not have any academic identity. Only three women's studies center made it a point to invite me year by year, every year, two or three times for the refresher course or orientation program. They were Delhi University, Guwahati University, and Kranti Jyoti Savitribai Phule Center, and one could get to understand what is feminist sisterhood that one found under the leadership of Sharmila Rege and Anagha Tambe and Sneha Gole and Swati Dehendroy, and they nurtured younger scholars. Sharmila was a widely discussed author and intellectual leader of Kranti Jyoti Savitribai Phule Women's Studies Center. She had a social activist also. She was surrounded by them. She entered into serious theoretical discussions. She was the bilingual teacher who gave equal importance to teaching in Marathi, dialogues in Marathi. She fought for her ideological commitments for the excluded and those who were brutalized sections of societies. She left her revolutionary legacy by mentoring her students and scholars. And she also, the students, they are in the interior parts of Maharashtra who are also comfortable in conversing in local language. I was pleasantly surprised when Sharmila Rege, professor and head of Department of Sociology, decided to join as a director and leader of Center for Women's Studies. So in a hierarchical institution such as university, a scholar established in mainstream disciplines switching to quote-unquote lower position without batting an eyelid showed her commitment towards women's studies in 2007. Under her leadership, the center became an intellectually vibrant center, providing platform to academicians, retired scholars, freelance researchers, social activists, feminists, and even college teachers. I had opportunity to meet Sharmila for 10 years continuously from 1996 to 2006 when I was invited at her center. And I was there used to be four lectures in a day from 10 to 11:30, 11:30 to 1, 2 to 3:30, 3:30 to 5, and I would be back to Bombay. On gender budgeting, globalization, sex selection, declining sex ratio, sexual harassment at workplace for refresher courses and certificate courses and diplomas by her center. I was impressed by the atmosphere of nurturance, voluntarism, cooperation created by Sharmila and her colleagues, even in the midst of tremendous financial crunch which the center faced at that time. None of them deserted center when it faced an existential crisis. I appreciate commitment of Dr. Gita, Chadha, and Dr. Joseph MT for today's online panel discussion on their edited volume and also remembering Sharmila Rege on this day of Guru Purnima. Now I request the editors to provide an overview of their book. Over to Dr. Gita, Chadha, and Dr. Joseph.
Thank you, Professor Patel. Joseph, I go ahead first.
Sure. Yeah.
So let me first start by thanking IMPRI for initiating this panel discussion, and particularly Professor Vibhuti Patel for taking personal interest in it. I of course thank all the panelists, Professor Sanjay Srivastava, who's really handheld us through the contributions to Indian sociology issue, which was on the same theme and came out of the same conference that this book came out from. I'm really honored that he's here. I'd like to thank Anagha Tambe for agreeing to be part of this. Let me remind her that they were also supposed to write for the volume. So since they were so busy at the time and couldn't do it, I'm really glad that she's here today. Dr. Smita Patil seems to be having some trouble with her internet, is what she's telling me, and her electricity, but I'm hoping that she'll be able to join us. So, you know, I was reading Anil Saini's post today, who is Sharmila Rege's partner, and he narrated a very interesting anecdote about Sharmila, and he said that, you know, we all know that Sharmila had a very difficult time when she lost her young nephew to leukemia, and that was something that was very, very traumatic for her. And Anil says in his post that Sharmila at that time would keep little artifacts, as he calls it, of gods and goddesses and things like that, because she went and worshipped everywhere. She went to all forms of faith to be able to, pray for her nephew. And the young boy didn't survive the disease. And Anil talks about how Sharmila then went and let go of all these icons and idols into the river, and said that never again will I turn to these images and icons and possibilities, because I believe that only we as humans are there for each other. But today he seems to have found, he says, a little packet which remained somewhere in one of the drawers. So I dedicate this discussion actually today to Sharmila's need to go to the temples and shrines, her need to then abandon them and let them go, and the fact that there is a little bit still left behind. I say this because I genuinely believe that a feminist sociology needs to look deeply into the question of faith today. So our volume is dedicated both to Sharmila Rege, because she was the first person who actually articulated more definitely contours of a sociology of gender and a feminist sociology. And that's Bita. And it is also dedicated to Kamala Ganesh, who was in our department of sociology, where Joseph and I both joined around 2013. And we will have another session on the 26th with Kamala Ganesh on the first part of this book, which is on the early women in sociology. So when Joseph and I joined the department, or rather Joseph had joined a little earlier than me, and the job of actually organizing the annual national seminar of the department fell on me, I toyed with the idea of what the theme should be and could be. And I found myself organically moving towards the idea of bringing my two passions together, which was feminism and sociology. And I realized that I was the 10th woman to have joined the department, which was almost 100 years old. Yeah, and that seemed to be like a very, very sad number. So we started looking at the question of numbers of women in sociology, and obviously we found the feminification problem. Feminization happens to the discipline in terms of the kind of engagements, that substantive engagements that we thought we were doing, questions of tradition, which Satish Deshpande speaks about when he's talking about the crisis of Indian sociology in the mid-90s. But what we found is that the question of numbers is of course crucial, You find a lot of women in sociology who are teaching sociology. You find a lot of students who come to sociology are girls. But you find a very interesting sort of a pyramid where you see that in probably this is changing increasingly, but in post-graduation departments and departments of higher education of sociology, we find fewer women. Yeah. That being the numbers problem, which hopefully we will talk again more on the 26th. We also recognize the fact that there was a lot of erasure and marginalization of feminist contributions to the discipline itself in the way our syllabus was constructed, in the way our syllabus was being taught in our pedagogic practices also. And, the history of the Bombay University department was recorded in the Sociological Bulletin in, I think, 2008 or 2009, where the legacy of the department was traced, I think it was in the 75th year, to G.S. Gurier, to A.R. Desai, to Patrick Geddes. And there was one article, of course, as Vibhuti Pen was also pointing out, on Neera Desai. And though she was considered to be outside because she was already in the women's studies domain, there was one article talking about Neera Desai within the region. But to mark the beginning, say, of a feminist sociology within our department, we found that the work of Kamala Ganesh was crucial to that. And that's how the double dedication happened to it. So the genesis of the volume was something like this, to be able to sort of understand, what is this feminization of our discipline and yet the erasure of feminist sociology and of women. As we start looking at the way concerns of gender or women's issues have come into the larger academia, what we see is there is, as we all know, the add-on approach, add women on, add a little module on gender, add something here, add something there, and that's how, and then there are the gender sensitization programs. That's one way in which concerns for gender and patriarchy enter the academy. The other way that happened was, as we know, is the Women's Studies Centers, and Sharmila belonged to one of the best, and we have Anagha here, and when and these Women's Studies departments, some of them, not all of them, some of them actually, and Sharmila was a very big critic of some of these departments where critical feminist studies was not happening, but the best of these brought in both intersectionality and a deep praxis to be rooted in the movement. So that was one way. But the problem that happens is a ghettoization of the women's studies departments. So now only women's studies will be done by the women's studies centers. And the third route in which gender and patriarchy concerns come in, critical feminist consciousness comes in, is through the disciplines. And that's where our volume is located, to be able to reimagine and construct our specific disciplines and to work from within sociology. I'd say that there are three directions: theoretical, methodological, and substantive, in which feminism in a way has managed to bend sociology. So in the introduction to contributions to Indian sociology, I talk about the need to both indiscipline and discipline both these constituencies of feminism and sociology so that a conversation becomes deeper. Methodologically, as we know, and I'm sure some of our panelists will speak about it, standpoint, reflexivity, and intersectionality have been three important axes on which we have changed the methodologies of social sciences, particularly sociology and anthropology. Not to say that it's only feminists who do it, but the way and the fashion and the manner in which we do it probably is unique. And then, of course, the substantive areas in which bringing in gender and patriarchy actually changes the theoretical and the discourse in those substantive areas. I'll just end by saying how I see the sociology of gender actually as one substantive area changing dramatically with feminism and where we need to take it. One is, of course, the question of intersectionality, which we will hear more about how we need to understand the constitution of women as being not a homogeneous category. The idea of the woman as a subject of feminism and feminist sociology is destabilized completely to bring in the notion of multiple women at the intersection of class, caste, sexuality, religion, ethnicity. The second area in which I would say that the sociology of gender as informed by feminist sociology should move is into looking at the what queer studies and queer movements have contributed or are continuing to contribute and shape our understanding of gender, destabilizing the gender binary, and speaking about gender as a much open-ended concept. And the third direction is where I see us integrating more deeply and conversing more deeply with masculinity studies, which are quite to be distinguished from men's rights movements. But masculinity studies, how we look, for example, at how men get constituted as men, and where is the need to sort of critique it if we have to also take the emancipatory project of feminism ahead. How do we bring men and masculinities into that project? So I'll just end there to say that the terrain of a feminist sociology in India contours is vast and immense, and I think we are all into it. I cannot end without talking about pedagogy, and I think that's because it's also about Sharmila today, and all of us are deeply, deeply passionate about what we do in the classroom, and I've drawn a lot upon Maitrey Chaudhary's work in how to look at the classroom as a starting point of developing critical and feminist pedagogies. So with that, I'll hand over to Joseph to take us further into what we've been trying to do in the volume.
Dr. Joseph, you have to unmute.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. Just to share my screen.
Yeah.
No, if you are not able to get the sound. Is it visible?
Yeah. Yes, it's visible.
So I mainly focus on one section of the book because our other panelists would be also looking at it. First of all, before I begin, I would like to thank IMPRI and particularly Professor Vibhuti Patel for making this possible, this book discussion very significantly in memory of Professor Sharmila Rege. And also I thank all three panelists and others who would also be adding on to what we have got to say. I straight away go into what I have prepared into my presentation. So these are two quotes that I have taken from our introduction where we visualize this volume as contributing towards the practice of sociology, feminist sociology in India, pioneered by people like Professor Sharmila Rege. Building upon the work of Sharmila Rege that aimed to develop conversations between sociology and feminism, because the book, as Dr. Gita already explained, is something that evolved from the seminar. In the seminar, we sought to foreground concerns of a feminist sociology in India, mapping methodological, theoretical, and substantive intersections between the two. The essays in the volume engage with historical, methodological, theoretical, pedagogical, and substantive aspects of the intersections of feminisms and sociologies. Now, these are the three sections that the book has. As you can see, it is very much an attempt at taking forward the discussions on feminism and sociology, the intersections there. You have the first section by reading and writing early women in sociology, and fortunately IMPRI has designed another session just on this section on 26th July. And then you have pedagogies and mentoring, living processes, and we hope that Dr. Anagha will have more to share on this, the second section. And the third section of the book is substantive transformations, erasures, intersections, and insertions. So I would like to focus on this third section a bit as part of introducing the themes in the book and the manner in which we are actually contributing towards the corpus of work at the intersection of feminisms and sociologies in India. So these are the chapters in that section. the titles are there, each one. I will just a little bit go one by one. There are in all six chapters in that section, which are largely the substantive section, which map the intersections between feminism and sociology in India. And then these are critical sections as well, where the authors are actually critically looking at the what has been done and certain absences, certain kind of areas that could be already visualized, and certain and mapping of certain initiatives and certain new areas. And almost all of these are also based taken from ethnographies of individual scholars, and that that's the strength of this section at the intersection of feminism and genders. So the first title is by Dr. Rukmini Sen, and it is titled Interrogating Non-Consent in Sexual Intimacies and Infringements, Mapping the Socio-Legal Landscape in India. This is a piece that addresses feminist jurisprudence, especially interrogating the complexities with regard to intimacy, consent, and desire. And there's a quote that I take towards the end of that chapter, where Dr. Rukmini talks about a new method of conceiving a socio-legal landscape in the feminist jurisprudential sense of women's desires through respect, happiness, and control over their intimate associations, and not merely through shaming. And it is a critique in that sense, that particular piece. This is followed by the piece by Pushpesh Kumar, Dr. Pushpesh Kumar, which is titled Desire, Violence, and Pink Money, Life of Courtees in a Small City of Western India. Now, this is where Pushpesh actually addresses the certain ways in which the issues of multiple genders is not fully addressed by certain feminist scholars, and he names that in his introduction. So he interrogates the manner in which feminist sociology has not sufficiently engaged with non-binary genders, particularly the disadvantaged and oppressed genders. And he positions this chapter as based on an ethnographic study of the courtees, a gender non-conformist and sexually marginalized group of men, mostly belonging to lower socioeconomic backgrounds. So you can see how the maxim of intersectionality is woven into this particular chapter that Pushpesh Kumar has actually contributed to the whole length. This is followed by the piece by Vishal Jadhav, Dr. Vishal Jadhav, which is titled Organizing Rule Through an Imagery of the Masculine, A Case of the Martial Marathas. And this is the piece which deals with constructions of masculinity in this book in a very visible manner. And Dr. Vishal Jadhav has looked at the colonial construction of the martial race, and taking the case study of the Marathas as a martial race. And the chapter is full of ethnographic account of, you know, the talims, which used to be organized in different parts of Maharashtra, where the construction of the Marathas as a martial race was reinforced. And there he ties up with the larger Maratha identity, not only with the martial masculinity, but also the other addition of the Marathas as the hardy peasant imaginary. So both of these are ethnographically represented in this particular work, which looks at the constructions of masculinity. The following chapter is by Dr. Manisha Rao, Interrogating the Sociology of Environment in Western India, A Gendered Understanding. This piece actually maps the interlinkages between gender and environment, and specifically from the field of sociology, of course. And it interrogates the contribution of women sociologists to the sociology of environment. I've taken a quote from the conclusion of the piece, where Dr. Manisha says, the consciousness of women with relation to environmental protection is different based on the extent of their dependence on the natural environment for fulfilling the productive and reproductive roles, again, mediated through their locations of caste and class. So her work, this piece, again, is intersectional because it's not only a mapping of the interlinkages between gender and environment, but it also looks at especially their connections with caste and class, and the work of people like Gail Ombret is mapped in the particular chapter. This is followed by Bindulakshmi Pattadat. Her work, the chapter is titled Gender, Mental Illness and the Everyday, Understanding the Interface of Psychiatry with the Lives of Women Diagnosed as Mentally Ill. I quote, by analyzing a number of narratives obtained from the field, this paper brings out the possibility of looking at the lives of women diagnosed from the point of view of an everyday taken for granted life, in which the bizarre, abnormal and irrational meet and interact with the normal and yet manage to survive in that normal social space. It's a very unique study of ethnography of women diagnosed as mentally ill and the lived everyday experience of those women and how they negotiate that space and the question of agency, the question of branding and the question of the entire interactions that take place there. And that is that chapter by Dr. Bindulakshmi Pattadat. And the final chapter in that section is by Dr. Rennie Thomas, which is titled Narratives in Feminist Sociology of Science, Contextualizing the Experiences of Women Scientists in India. Again, another piece based on an ethnography based in Bangalore. He titles it A Feminist Sociology and Anthropology of Science. Again, I quote here, a feminist sociology of science would challenge the masculinity of science by looking at the specific experiences of Dalits, women, and minorities in the sciences. It also would question the scientific masculinity of sociology by listening to more Dalit, tribal, OBC, and minority men and women sociologists. So it's again a critique of what he calls scientific masculinity and a plea for a different way of doing sociology, especially when we are doing the sociology of science, where he looks at the preeminence of narratives as very much a feminist way of doing sociology. And that's what Rennie brings out in that particular particular kind of chapter. So this is the section, a substantive section where we the book maps the intersections of feminism, sociology with other substantive areas. And these are the chapters that deal with it. And I think it is really fitting into the memory of Dr. Sharmila Rege as we analyze these intersections between feminism and sociology in India. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Gita Chadha, for giving an eagle's eye view of emancipatory project of feminist sociology, and Dr. Joseph for bringing out, giving us the profile of the third section of the book on substantive transformation, erasure, intersections, and insertions, and also bringing out this very important concept of scientific masculinity of sociology. I would say that it would be positivist school, which has reigned supreme in the sociology as a field, and structural functional analysis that has also reigned like nearly for 40 years of Indian sociology. That was the one which had a monopoly over intellectual exercise that happened in sociology as a discipline. Now I would like to ask Dr. Smita Patel about to speak about what is the response to the book as well as their experiences with Sharmila Rege. Over to Dr. Smita Patel.
Ma'am, she's not here.
Dr. Patel. Okay. I think Smita is unable to join for
okay,
some
okay, okay. So I think then we can ask Anagha, who has worked closely with Dr. Sharmila Rege, as well as she has also done her PhD, I think, with her. And she is also continuing the legacy of feminist sociology in the city of Pune. Yeah. Over to Dr. Anagha.
Thank you, Vibhuti, Dr. Vibhuti Patel, Dr. Gita Joseph, and Dr. Gita Chadha, and Dr. Joseph, and of course, IMPRI team for having me here. I mean, it is very poignant that I speak in memory of Sharmila today on the possibilities of feminism and women's studies. As it has been said earlier, my journey in women's studies has been shaped by Sharmila and our team of a collective of researchers, teachers, and students at the center. And I'm really glad that I would be speaking on this volume that is dedicated to Sharmila, and which actually unpacks the feminist potential in sociology, in reimagining sociology in India. I mean, as Gita said, me and Swati were supposed to be a part of this volume. We couldn't be at that time. We didn't actually at that time. But I'm glad that I'm speaking here. I mean, I think it is very significant that one out of the three sections, as has been outlined, focuses on pedagogies, something that has defined Sharmila's work in intersection with her research, politics, and institutional work. And I really wonder, would or did feminist engagement with other disciplinary or interdisciplinary fields foregrounded pedagogies in this way? The intertwining of the pedagogical and theoretical seems to be distinct to sociology, sociological imagination, as it does to the critical space of women's studies. Though we cannot explore, but the examination of practices and pedagogies of sociology of gender, and sociology actually more generally, has been crucial to the feminist sociologists also in India. And Maitri Chaudhary, whom Gita Chadha quote, is one of the pioneering in that. These feminist sociologists saw themselves as outsiders within the positionality that gave them unique capabilities to critique and challenge the institutions in which they are embedded. But I will discuss this, and I mean here today I will discuss this book focusing this question of pedagogies. As I said, let me first admit that I am a sociologist by training. Actually, my PhD has been in Mumbai University with Professor Jognan, but I have taught actually for over 2 decades now women's studies. So my thinking of feminist pedagogies is located in more amorphous space of women's studies, which is peripheral within the university structure, as compared to the discussion in this book on the disciplinary space of sociology. The section on pedagogies in this book has 3 chapters, looking at this question significantly from 3 different positionalities, that of mentee, mentor, teacher, and student. And interestingly, all the 3 chapters are autobiographical, bringing in subjectivity in their discussions. And how do discussions on critical pedagogies often become autobiographical is a question that would need far more actually consideration than what I will be attempting here. In this book, we have Anurekha Chariwa unraveling rather uncharted process of mentoring, about which we know so less and significance of which is still unexamined in the mapping of sociological knowledge production in India. She discusses elaborately the micro practices of mentoring, affective questions of trust, vulnerability, charisma, as well as material, the questions of legacy making, both formal and informal practices concerning not only academia, but also the life worlds of mentees. She raises this question about reflexive possibilities of mentoring, self-interrogation in feminist sociologies, given the disciplinary space of sociology and also the university structures entrenched in inequalities. Then Lina Pujari, in another chapter, talks about the pedagogies of reflexivity and subjectivity in her undergraduate classroom in the Metropolitan College, resisting standardization in doing sociology. She elaborates on its challenges and dilemmas in the context of wider institutional structures and its chilly climate, as well as student subjectivities and voices. And Akhila Bhargav and Ria De Silva in this book talk about their journeys of finding feminisms as students in life, as well as academia, as they say, sociology in particular, how their engagement with feminist sociology and doing theory more generally is molded by their gendered selves, experiences of feminist pedagogies as students. I mean, both of them had very differential experiences of feminist pedagogies, which points out the unevenness in the transaction of feminist pedagogies in the classroom and outside, something that both Lina Pujari and even Anurekha allude to, and a caution against the pedagogical romanticism. We therefore need much more such accounts, descriptions, and critical analysis of feminist teaching learning practices in the everyday to understand and address the unevenness of these pedagogies across disciplines, institutional spaces, positionalities, and more. So I'm not really going into the discussion of critical pedagogies here, which has received wide addressal in the fields of sociology and feminism from diverse orientations. I mean, from utilitarian and inclusionary to radical transformative. I would rather put forth some questions raising from this book, from this section, trying to read those in the context of Sharmila's seminal work on Phule, Ambedkarite feminist pedagogies that challenge the binaries of reason versus emotion, public and private, assumptions of neutral objectivity and celebration of experience. So how do we relocate the individual struggles in the classrooms and think of critical pedagogies as a collective endeavor of diverse teachers, students, educationists, and activists committed to equality? How do we challenge the misconstrued opposition between critical feminist pedagogies and institutionalization of these feminist practices to explore more democratic and collective possibilities of institutionalization, albeit in the constraints of the neoliberal university and its modes of efficiency and austerity? How do we seek to disrupt the boundaries of classrooms to rethink the politics of knowledge, bringing in diverse practices, I mean, from some of the practices that feminists have actually already looked at are Wikipedia editathons, unmasking standards of neutrality and inclusivity, or MOOCs and online pedagogies, encouraging digital native students to engage in production of selves, or to conferencing, feminist conferencing for dialogue and care, and storytelling, theater, and translation for embodied learning, reimagining borders of all kinds. And how do we learn from these alternative modes of radical study, not just in education, but also in, I mean, outside of academia, in speak out groups and unions, and in social protests more generally, which are also an important spaces, significant critical spaces of studying committed to social justice. So if we recognize that the teacher is not the sole source of power in the classroom, with complex social inequalities among students, and especially as teachers from marginalized groups, they mark their way into academia, then the multi-layered power dynamics force us to think about not just collaboration in pedagogies, but contention, confrontation, and risk in the practices of critical pedagogies. When social science departments are becoming more diverse in terms of students and teachers, the individual pursuit of critical pedagogies may become not just limiting, but at best confusing, and at worst condescending towards Dalit, Bahujan, Adivasi students and teachers, making them illegible. Making it a collective project, partnership may be a difficult, painful, but a rewarding struggle. Sharmila turned the talking back of the students. I mean, in her piece on Phule, Ambedkarite pedagogies, she turned the talking back of students from Dalit groups post 1990s into a space to rethink the epistemological as well as pedagogical questions by reading those new times in the context of disciplinary history of sociology that hides the fear of identity under the language question. So the Phule, Ambedkarite feminist pedagogies underlines the interrogation of authority and canon. It does not take place in vacuum, but with deep engagement with the interrogation of but with deep engagement with the subjectivities of students and teachers, with the changes within the university, and with the histories of dissent and subversive knowledge production. How can we reimagine pedagogies in contemporary volatile times then, when public universities are becoming embattled but intimate spaces producing dissent? The protests against institutional murder of Rohit Vemula, Me Too, the list are some of these moments. So Amita Bhaviskar in her piece actually warns us against the partisan pedagogy in support of subaltern groups that suppress critical reflexive questions. How do we then recognize that the changes in pedagogies need to be accompanied with the struggle for change in academia and also the radical social protests outside of academia? The radical pedagogies we strive for is a public issue, not a personal one, that we struggle alone in our individual classrooms. We need to make it consciously and clearly a part of the broader struggle, collective action for social justice. So thank you, I'll stop here.
Mute.
Thank you, Anagha, for providing us a very important analysis of critical feminist pedagogies and the mentoring processes as professional in the personal realm, and institutionalization of feminist pedagogies in the neoliberal context of individuation, and linking some of these dilemmas to Sharmila Rege's contribution within academia and her association with the social activism with Dalit, Bahujan and Adivasis. Now I request Professor Sanjay Srivastava to give his reflections on the book as well as the contribution of Sharmila Rege.
Thank you. I'm sorry, there's someone talking in the background and someone's, okay. Thank you, Gita and Joseph, for inviting me, and it's a great honor to be here at a discussion which is in memory and in honor of Sharmila's work, and also I think it's also Kamala Ganesh's work, and it's wonderful to be here. What I'm going to do is just divide my brief, very brief talk into two bits. One is the having been one of the editors of Contributions to Indian Sociology, and we published in 2018, a volume in commemoration of contribution 50th anniversary, the new series. And just to think about what was there and then think about this particular volume and just offer some very stray random comments. The book, Critical Themes in Indian, Indian Sociology, edited by Yasmin Arif, Janaki Abraham and myself, published in 2018, so roughly the same time. It had 23 chapters, and I was looking over it when I was thinking about this particular present discussion about how gender influence of feminism was handled in the collection. So there were 23 chapters, out of which five were specifically looked at gender and sexuality. There was a chapter called Contemporary Intimacies, another one called Gendering Sociology, a Sociology of Gender or Studying Women. Another called Conjugality and Marital Dissolution in Historical Perspective. A fourth one, Gender and Law and the Law. And the fifth one called Alternating Sexualities, Sociology and Queer Critiques in India. Now, these are just five chapters. However, there were 17 others. And so I looked through kind of other chapters because, I mean, it would be a pity if only five out of 23 addressed gender in a specific, substantial manner. So then looking through the other chapters, there was a discussion of informed by feminist theories of different kinds, gender and ID cards, gender and internet culture, gender and cultures of labor, gender and work, gender and middle classness, gender and the idea of tribe and caste, gender and disability, gender and aging, gender and food, gender and cinema. So I think what has happened is the influence, the work, the historical labor of feminist sociologies has in many ways seeped into sociology. I'm not saying in a kind of, I'm not going to argue that it's happened in a way that we should be happy to sort of sit back and say that the work is done. But you can see what's happened over the last few decades from a dismissal of, or a strict distinction between, as the book also points out in different ways, between people who do sociology and people who do feminism, to manner, the manner in which the social itself proceeds from recognizing gender as an indispensable manner in which we discuss what is social life, what is human life. So let me now just go on to the book itself. People already pointed out that there's three different parts. Now the book, just kind of reading through various bits and pieces, is of course, it's a conversation between sociology and feminism, right? Especially on the topic of how it is that they can be seen to be separate. How is it they've come to be separate, can come to be seen as separate, and hence need to be brought into conversation, right? If they have been brought into conversation, it also has come from a point of view of this, a certain separation what it is to be professional sociologists and who does certain kinds of things, as the editors and several other contributors point out. The book is also, of course, an attempt to pluralize both sociological and feminist thinking. And I think that's something worth thinking about. What does it mean to pluralize both sociology, but also feminism? So by which I would say, for example, so I have students, for example, who say want to work on shopping malls, right? And one of the really interesting things is that from a feminist point of view, you would argue in some ways that shopping malls, from an environmental point of view, another point of view, you might say shopping malls are terrible things. But actually, from some points of view, in terms of spaces for young women to meet in a deeply asymmetrical society, from a feminist point of view, shopping malls may not be such a bad thing. I mean, I'm putting that very somewhat simplistically, but it's worthwhile thinking about what it might mean to both pluralize sociology, but how sociology becomes pluralized through connection with feminism, and what might it mean to also pluralize feminism in ways, in different kinds of ways. We can perhaps discuss that. So the peculiar nature of, and that the book is also, I think, very importantly about the peculiar nature of the relationship in sociology, women sociologists, and feminism in India in particular. So the relationship, the constraint, and the constraint the female women sociologists have faced within the discipline, the particular nature of sociology as a discipline that seeks to bring about change, foster change, and the involvement of women sociologists in worlds outside sociology, precisely as the nature of the constraints that they face within the discipline, ironically, because of course, and that's something, again, I'm taking from the book, and says something that all of you would be familiar with. And this is something peculiar about sociology, the relationship between sociology and feminism, how feminism comes to be a part of sociology in India, and what I think editors referred to as the outside of sociology. And that's something quite, I think, peculiar, characteristic of feminism in India and sociological feminism in India and feminist sociology in India, if you like. So as the editor said, we submit that while assessing the contribution of sociologists, particularly women sociologists who did not have an easy access to the inside of sociology, these outer sociology interventions must be taken on board. And I think that's really important in terms of tracing histories of knowledge and how knowledges are produced in specific contexts. And of course, there's the identity, gender, caste versus the professionalization issue, right? That's very, and I want to just briefly in my conclusion, I want to come back to that. So as the editor said that there's a tension in Parvathamma's work between the pull of the necessary politics for justice from our caste location and the pull of a disciplinary training that emphasized stability, social order, and an apolitical sociology. And that's something I'll come back to in terms of an idea of method and how can feminism contribute? What should it contribute? Now, the key aspect of the book, just to carry on with my discussion, concerns, it seems to me, as different from, say, the critical themes in the sociology volume that I just mentioned, is an exploration of the grounds upon which knowledge is produced and how biographies of those who produce it are and should be inextricably interwoven into the making of that knowledge. And I think in many ways, that's what I think is an important contribution of a volume like this. And I think differentiates it from other collections which draw upon feminist thinking and gender studies in general. So then autobiography as an element of feminist research, careers, and pedagogy. Okay. Autobiographical sociology hasn't found the favor that it should. And although it's not such, I mean, there are books on it's not, it really hasn't been a problem for many anthropologists. So Joseph Alter, for example, has a book on working with his informant. And many anthropologists use it, do use autobiographical vignettes to structure a particular line of thinking. But and yet I think it hasn't, it still doesn't find as much favor as I think, it doesn't find as much of a place as I think it should. And I think that should be a very important contribution. When you think about of feminism and feminist sociology, when you think specifically about Indian feminist sociology and the relationship between sociology in India and feminism in India, because after all, as the editors point out, and many others in the collection point out, it's a significant part of the politics of production of knowledge, social science knowledge in the Indian context. And in a very kind of a direct sense, that is where you think of the personal as the both the political, but also the epistemological. And I think that's something that I would just mention that. Now, secondly, just moving towards a conclusion, I think we also require, the book suggests, multiple histories of knowledge from around the world. Now, I'm a bit iffy about the term neoliberalism, not because I don't think there are neoliberal processes, but I think that it doesn't actually explain very much, because now we use the neoliberalism to explain almost everything. Neoliberalism weddings, neoliberalism books, neoliberalism infrastructure, neoliberalism universities. I think what we really need is a local histories of capital, okay? And neoliberalism presents us a very global history of capital. In a similar sense, I think what this book offers, suggests to us that in the same way, we require local histories of the production of knowledge. How is knowledge produced in different parts of the world? We need local histories of the imbrication between feminism, knowledge, and the kinds of worlds of being and believing that this relationship produces. And for different parts of the world, it is very different. I think that's the other strength, I think, of this particular book. And it goes back to some of the comments that I made earlier, just as the feminists increasingly question the notion of a universal woman. I think feminist knowledge, when it contributes to sociological knowledge and pluralizing it, should also question the idea of a universal feminist production of knowledge. And I think that's something, you know, that's where intersectionality comes in, you know, the ideas of caste, class, local histories of capital. And I would say, I'm going to just go back to the early point I was making. Why is it that so many young women like gated communities and shopping malls? I mean, either we can, either feminists might just say this is all false consciousness, or we need to think about how do we think through it in terms of the asymmetries that exist in society, and how does one apply a feminist thinking to that particular world of women who after all exist? It's not that these are women who are sort of in a minority and we can just say like, this is just, they're not thinking straight, right? And so what follows among the other things is the meaning of feminist pedagogy. What should, as I think the earlier speaker was saying, what should feminist pedagogy be all about? How to put in practice a mix of academic and non-academic contexts, a context that produce feminist thought into practice. How do we put this in acts of teaching? And that's really crucial and something that all of us struggle with, some certainly more than others. And it's not something that I think is perhaps something we can say that we are, that this is what it is. It's always a process of development. Semi-finally, though, my second last point is that the point that was mentioned earlier, I think we also need to think about there's been a recent book, well, not recent, published in 2018, a book edited by Romit Chowdhury and Zayed Al-Basset, which is called Men and Feminism in India. What should be the relationship between men who teach in the university in social sciences, who at least profess to have some kind of feminist belief and feminism, but who may be part of masculinity? So what should be the relationship? How should we think about it? I mean, no one gives up power voluntarily. That's certainly true. So how should we think about the relationship between masculinity studies and men and feminism? And finally, I think a final point that I want to make is that the relationship between sociology and feminism is, I don't think that it is specific to sociology. I think it's much more linked to the nature of institutions, number one, and the nature of the method in social sciences. You know, even now, and I think one of the things that feminist thinking can contribute to social sciences, even now students will come to you, PhD students will come to you and say, what is the ideal sample size? you know, that is the most unfeminist question in sociology. I mean, you can, one person can tell you something that can make an entire book, and that will inform, that can provide as much information as 100%. So the only feminist answer to the question, what is the ideal sample size, is how long is a piece of string, right? I mean, I don't know, who knows, right? So I think that what we need to think about is, in fact, I would argue that of almost all the social science disciplines, I'm not really including economics in different ways, I think sociology is in fact much more amenable to feminist thinking and to being bent in certain kinds of ways. It's the most capable of engaging the task of feminism as well as open to them. So I think partly it is very much about the institution, the kinds of universities that we have and what they expect from us. And secondly, it is about the nature of social sciences. I mean, I think the kind of methods we, all of us might subscribe to, and also the kind of, I often feel, you know, I did economics, my BA and MA, and when I tried to decide to switch to anthropology or sociology, my grandmother thought this was a terrible thing, like, oh, what kind of man does sociology, right? And partly, I think many of us sociologists have never really recovered from that in terms of a competition that we think sociology must provide to other disciplines with having a method which is quantifiable. And that's why you still have a lot of PhD students who are very anxious about that, saying, what is the ideal sample size? That if I only talk to 10 people, will my PhD be taken seriously? So I want to end by saying that part of the problems of and what contribution that feminism can make have to do with the nature of institutions, where the social sciences are based and what they ask of us, and with the methods of the social sciences themselves. And just to end with, I think the sociology is actually quite amenable, as we have seen, not without a fight, as all of you are right, to engaging the task of feminism and the kinds of behavioral changes, the epistemological changes, the methodological changes, which I think are crucial to the making of a feminist sociology. Stop there. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Sanjay Srivastava, for bringing out a very, very important question of personal is political. And I think that is where the major opposition of the mainstream sociology lies. And importance of local histories of production for production of knowledge, that's very important. I would like to mention here Nirabhan's study, which is published by Sparrow, about the feminism as experience, where she interviewed, in-depth interview of 100 feminists of Western India she did, and provided a sociological analysis. So I think what you see that, and I fully agree with you that sociology is the first discipline which was amenable to change and which was very positive in responding to feminist praxis. And right, that you could see its reflection even in the Towards Equality report in 1972 and Shrama Shakti report under chairpersonship of Ila Ben Bhatt, which applied both the quantitative and qualitative aspect and also rigorous feminist analysis, where a person like Nira Desai, Dr. Leela Dubey, Namajita, all of them part of the, they spearheaded the studies. So thank you very much. Now I would like to turn to the chapter contributors. The first of all, it would be Anurekha Chari, madam, and her chapter is on sociology, feminism, and mentoring, contested sites of knowledge production and consumption. Over to Dr. Anurekha Chari.
You're muted, Anu. Can't hear you. You're muted.
Yes, please.
You have to increase the volume, Anurekha, I think, Anu. It's very feeble. We can't hear you.
Dr. Kumar, we've given speaker access.
Ma'am is there. And can you check your audio? Okay, I will coordinate with you. Ma'am, if you can go ahead. Ma'am, please unmute. Vibhuti, ma'am, please unmute.
Please, Dr. Rukmini Sen, please introduce your chapter. Hello. Dr. Rukmini Sen, your chapter Interrogating Non-Consent in Sexual Intimacies and Infringements, Mapping the Socio-Legal Landscape in India. Please introduce your chapter.
Thank you very much. It's absolutely a delight to be here and this panel discussion, book discussion being organized by IMPRI. So thank you so much for doing that. And also, we are doing this in memory of Sharmila Rege. It's an honor to be here. It was wonderful to be part of this book. As the title of the chapter actually says, what this chapter tried to do was the following, which is to engage with the concept of consent, or rather also with the concept of non-consent, because primarily when feminist discussions have engaged with the concept of consent, it has mainly been in the area of rape and sexual violence. Over a period of time, it has also been in areas related to sexual harassment. Sexual assault and sexual violence broadly. What this chapter tried to do is to actually look at, of course, this aspect of consent, consent debates around consent and non-consent in relation to rape and sexual harassment, but also to look at age as a very important connect to consent, primarily because the age of consent debate has been one which has historically defined the conception of consent. The third discussion, taking the discussion to the terrain of marriage, but actually to the terrain of choosing one sexual partner, consent to choose one sexual partner, and debates attached to that, especially in connection to questions around honor killing, questions, you know, those kinds of questions. And fourth, to actually go back to the Indian Penal Code's legal provision around consent, section 90 of the Indian Penal Code, which is actually consent, which has to do with contract. So consent to contract and who can do that. So through all of this, the entire purpose was actually to understand that how is it that using a feminist sociological perspective, how is it that we can actually broaden the understanding of consent? And I think to engage with the this broadened understanding of consent, what this chapter did, and I want to talk about three things in connection to how it probably contributes to feminist sociology broadly. One is to rethink how do we study and do kinship, primarily because the entry point still remains either biological kinship or marriage-based kinship, and how is it that we actually move from there to questions around intimacies and relationships, and understand, and therefore understand consent in a more complex manner, and the fact that consent actually plays out in all kinds of domestic spaces. So that's one in terms of, you know, kinship as a study, kinship as an institution. Second would be law as an institution. And how is it that through the interrogation of law or limits of law, can we actually understand consent and, you know, the extremely complex, blurry zones around transgressions, sexual transgressions? How is it that you can capture it through the concept of consent, through a very limited understanding of consent that seems to be there in the law? And finally, one kind of a proposal that this chapter makes to contribute to feminist sociology is that the need to do discussions around intimacy and desire. And in order to do that, to actually take the contributions of queer studies and sexuality studies into the discussion, to broaden the base of feminist sociology. So in some ways, what one tried to do in this chapter is to kind of go back to histories of age of consent and then end with where is it that one needs to move to by foregrounding questions of intimacy and desire. I'm extremely grateful to the editors for having given me this opportunity to write in this book and also to make me a part of this discussion. Thank you. Professor Patel, you need to...
Thank you, Professor Rukmini Sen, to deconstruct the concept of consent, which is heavily debated and also brought to the fore by Me Too movement, as well as the current debate on marital rape also, because it is also within the intimate partner, it's part of the violence and the anomaly that we face. Levy Act accepts sexual violence as a crime. Protection of women from domestic violence act, while the broader this thing that the Indian Evidence Act doesn't even consider it as a part as a sexual violence. So this anomaly exists even in the current legal system. So it's very important here. This this whole age old debate right from the time of Ratmabai and Phulmani Devi, Phulmani Dasi till now. So now I would like to request Dr. Manisha Rao, who has worked closely with Sharmila Rege. She also has some very important photographs, a private photograph collect from her private collection, as well as she is a contributor to the chapter for chapter on Interrogating Sociology of Environment in Western India, a Gendered Understanding. Over to Dr. Manisha Rao.
Thank you, Professor Vibhuti Patel. Am I audible?
Yeah.
Thank you so much. For inviting me to be part of this discussion. And I must hold Dr. Gita too. You know, I'm going to see her university mein dekh lenge, because it's just a last minute sort of push. So I'm just going to share some memories.
I'm so glad you agreed to be bullied a little bit. Thank you for doing
it. It's not bullying, it is nudging.
Nudging, yes. Let us be.
So right, so correct.
So thank you so much for this. But, I've had an immense number of memories with Sharmila, and I think everyone who's been in touch with her, who's read her work, who's, you know, been taught by her, or whatever, has been her student, as colleague, whatever. All of us have a number of memories with her as an academic, as a scholar, as an activist, as a teacher, a mentor, a guide, and a friend. But I feel after her untimely death, you know, there is this larger than life image of Sharmila that has developed. But what I'd like to share with you through some of the images that I was able to retrieve in this hour that I got, think back and collect some of those photographs, that she was just as human as you and me, and just as, sensitive. She was someone who gave all her, passion into whatever she was doing, but she also had, made mistakes, had faults, what have you. She also had another side to her life. I remember very well, though I don't have a photograph of that. She used to love Western music. She used to have this jeans, a short jeans jacket with steel studs, and she had colored her hair pink once. Unfortunately, I don't have that photograph, but, these are memories that maybe we can dig them out with from Anil or someone, elsewhere. So it's just that, what I'd like to say is that she was someone who encouraged everyone, whether it was her colleagues, her students, her, staff members at the university and the department. For all of us in the 90s at the Department of Sociology in the University of Pune was life for us. So if we, we all just lived there, and all of us, I think she was also at that time in the midst of writing her PhD work. and she was teaching at the department part-time. And that's when we as students were there in the masters, and we had started this group, a student-teacher group called Samvad, where we used to discuss, you know, whatever issues, whether it was hostel issues or, you know, something in the city of Pune that had happened, or, you know, the marches that we would take on 8th of March to Chanwarwada, or, you know, a number of issues, or a student suicide that happened on campus, issues of patriarchy within the family, outside, all of these things that we would just, you know, just come together and discuss. Or it was also, you know, she would see to it, now you have all these things about, you know, encouraging students to write, to make drafts of your research writings, make multiple drafts, and she would see to it as students, she would also give us these little tests that, okay, let us see how much you have learned and whether you've learned, and she would sit and correct all of them and give us all feedback. You see, to each one of us that, okay, this is where you have, you know, you should have brought this in, you should have thought about this, things like that. Writing papers, we'd started this student teacher, you know, a research scholars forum where we'd have a seminar, and it was something that was, you know, all of us would get together and present our, you know, ideas, thoughts, or whatever research work that we were working on. And it was, you know, it was these things that really brought us all together. And it was not only, you know, that student-teacher relation, that distance or that hierarchy wasn't there. And it was something that we also shared with the non-teaching staff at the university. So it was all of us together. So that's what I would like to share with you in terms of these small photographs, just a few photographs that I've had. And also she was very known for these, you know, working lunches that she would have if she had a seminar. And that working lunch would be like a bare minimum. But other times we would also have this vast meal. We would all sit together and cook and share the meal. So it's also the other side that one can see. I'm not sure if I'm able, let me just try to share my screen. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am, you can go full screen.
Full screen. How do I do that?
Yes, slideshow. Yes, that one, slideshow.
That one?
Slideshow. Yes.
Where is the slide?
Top right, yeah. Just below that, below your cursor, there is slideshow. Yes. No, ma'am, little up. Where?
This one?
Upar themes ke upar slideshow.
Oh, okay. It's covered. I was not able to put music and make it a very beautiful, you know, sharing of... but I'm just sharing some photographs of our memories here. So this was the entrance to the department where we were all students, staff, faculty. This is Sharmila. This is our librarian, department librarian, Mr. Mahendra Pawar, who also died just before, I think a year before Sharmila, and that really sort of disturbed her very, very much. Not only her, but everyone else also, because it was an untimely and unrequired, actually, pass. This was field trips that we went for, and she would be very much part and parcel of the field trips with students and faculty at the department. We used to have something called a fish pond at the department, at, you know, these when we have these welcome parties, welcoming freshers or farewell parties. I think this was one such occasion where we were pulling her leg and she was game.
We should that. All do this.
Yes, yes. We used to pull each other's leg, whether it was teachers, students. So that was one. And this is her sitting and doing her, you know, writing. And you can see the drafts that she's, can't see that clearly, but here you can see the various drafts of her writing that she would have. And earlier, I mean, at that time, I don't think we were so savvy with the computer, so it was written. And I think that has remained with us, because writing out an argument, writing out a paper on, you know, pen and paper is something that really sort of stays on. And you can see this little doll of hers that is there, and innovative little things that she would, you know, she, or I think probably that was Anil who made that, that little. This was the student research seminars. You can see her here, where all of us would be, you know, presenting our papers, and there would be discussions and question and answers, so that it was like a little stepping stone for us as we went out into the wider world, into our, you know, whatever futures we had for ourselves at the department. I think this is room number 2. Anurekha and Anagha would probably be able to say. This is a very personal thing. She would always see to it that, you know, remember our birthdays and give us these little, you know, either book or something, and with a little note on it where she says, dearest Manisha, happy birthday, looking forward to your articles on Yakshagana, which I still have to do. I'm sorry, I've not yet been able to do that. The other thing that she's written here is, dear Manisha, for your concerns of environment, consumption, and a better world, belated, but ambitious. So, you know, these little things would always be there. We would expect it almost that, oh, my birthday has come and gone, and, you know, Sharmila has, would have this little thing for us. But somewhere it's also sort of telling us that, you know, she's expecting you to, she knows the area of your research. She, you know, she's very engaged with us and our work, and she would expect us to come out with something. So I still have that to do as yet with the Yakshagana article. This was at the canteen where we would have lunch, and we would also, the Samvad, as I mentioned, this was the student group. Later we got a room in one of the hostels, or I don't recollect, some place where we got a room, but earlier it would be out in the open where we would have discussions with other, I mean, various students come together and have discussions on various issues. This was again at the canteen where staff, faculty, students would all sit together and have lunch, share their dabbas or share food from the canteen. And this was like fun times. We were all dressed up and we'd make these huge amounts of food. And we said, okay, let us have this traditional day. And I think it is Bisibele Bhat that I made. And it, of course, went into a huge quantity because I was not sure of quantity sizes at that time. And, you know, so you can see her all dressed up, which I'm sure this is a picture of her. Not many of you would have seen, with bangles and a nice, beautiful sari and her hair all grown up. And I think, no, maybe the tinge is just the red. It was much earlier when she'd colored her hair pink. So, I just wanted to share these memories that we have with her. There are many, many more memories which I'm sure everyone treasures with her. But I think one should also think of her as just a human being, just as all of us are. Yeah, and that is something that, you know, it, her work on, you know, her major work on writing caste, writing gender, the last one that she did on the madness of Manu, it is something that is a outcome of a lot of hard work. It was not something that she knew that she was going to be doing that, you know, because when she started out, her PhD was on a feminist analysis of feminist perspectives on sociology. And it was only later that she, you know, she began, she sort of she started thinking about the Dalit feminist issue, and it was something that she learned, and she, it was not something that she knew. She was not, she had been trained, she had gone to school in an English medium school, you know, and a middle class sort of family, locality. And so it was only after coming into sociology and dealing with, reading and writing of feminism, that she then began to change. And it was after that. So it is something that it's not, because many a times we think, at least for myself, it's something that, you know, we are rootless because we have traveled all over the country. We do not have a particular, we are not from one particular place. But even she, though she was from that place, she had, different experiences. But then she decided that this is where she was, she wanted to do her work. And that was something that was, she was very passionately involved with. And she, went into that and trained herself and did that. So it's something that all of us, I think one has to really learn a lot from her and her life and her commitment. Yeah, thank you so much. Thanks, Gita. Thanks, Joseph. Thank you, Professor Patel, for giving me this opportunity.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Manisha Rao, for bringing out this humane and sensitive aspect. I also answered, because whenever I used to go to the center for a refresher course, I would be the first person to reach because I would take the 6 o'clock Volvo, and the session, I would be at the campus by 9:30, while session would start at 10, and someone would quietly put a hand on my shoulder. Listen, Vibhuti, would you like to have a cup of coffee? And then she would go to coffee machine and bring it. Such small things, though, but it shows what kind of person she was. Just looking at the face of a person, she would understand that person's grief. Now, Dr. Rukmini, Dr. Anurekha Chari, are you ready?
Yeah, can you hear me now? Yes. Okay. Thank you, Professor Vibhuti Patel, IMPRI Gita, and Joseph. Thank you so much. I have to say that when Manisha Dee was showing all the photographs, it is no wonder that all of us, when we were students, we were fascinated by her. I remember when she used to walk, when we used to sit in our desk and she used to walk, we used to have this thing that who will touch her dupatta, so that it just kind of, reverts back to us. But I think, working or engaging with some of her ideas, especially with regard to gender, caste, and pedagogies, did not come, I didn't know that I was supposed to be working on that, it was there somewhere in my mind. And I think this is a book, or this conference, really, and the discussions that I had with Gita was with regard to how do I channelize that idea that for me, individuals, especially in terms of when teachers and students are in positions of differential power, it creates a certain kind of circuits of knowledge production. And it becomes more important when we define ourselves and identify ourselves as feminist sociologists. So taking that into account, I started with writing on feminist mentoring and talking about subjectivities, talking about power dynamics which exist between teachers and students, and also something in terms of when over a period of time there is also shifts in terms of power which is there. And this was one area that, because there is a lot of uncertainties, a lot of career decisions are made, a lot of camps are there, especially when you're doing your PhD and all, and you're very afraid. And also, this was a very challenging terrain. But I realized that once I started working on issues of mentoring, especially in terms of dynamics of knowledge production within the circuits of knowledge which are there, either within a teacher or a student or within the classroom, this is somewhere that I really want to work on. And since the book, since the conference, this is the area that I have been working on. And of course, taking and engaging with Sharmila's understanding with regard to Phule, Ambedkarite feminist pedagogy. So then I had a chance in terms of the plenary at IS, Indian Sociological Society, again organized by Gita, to look into the classrooms. So basically, one of the things that I understood, or and that is what I take from Sharmila's intervention, both as a teacher and as an academic, that I very much respect and I very much draw my inspiration from, is the fact that when we are looking into the subjectivities of different groups, especially different marginal groups of teachers and students within the classroom, classrooms, there is not only a lot of power that gets understood, but also it brings into concern a lot of vulnerabilities, both with the students and with the teachers, because it is, I mean, I've been teaching sociology of gender for a very long time, and I've realized that it is not as if that all of us who are in the classroom are interested in these issues, right? So it is not as if that everyone would be interested in sharing their experiences, so on and so forth. And these sharing of experiences brings in so much of vulnerabilities, both as a teacher, and that it becomes very challenging as a teacher to handle that. And how do you make the classroom safe? So that is something that is what I've been now working on, in terms of how do you make your classroom safe, looking at the experiences of the teachers. And I think there is one more thing that Sharmila's work ethic, Sharmila's the way in which, you know, she understood the challenges of making the personal as political and feminist as praxis, is a fact that many of us as feminist sociologists do not understand or do not want to understand or recognize the privilege that we have, either in terms of our gender or in terms of our caste, class, language, and so on. And this is something also which I think the work that I've been doing in recent times on looking at privilege also draws from, in the way Sharmila always kind of also understood her own privilege and interrogating it and engaging with it. So I think somewhere for me, right from looking at the work that I did for the book in terms of the mentoring, to now looking at classrooms, to now understanding the fact that there is this one area which really needs lot of focus, that as someone who is being inspired by Sharmila's work, is to look at also one's own autoethnographical journey in order to understand what does it mean to be a feminist sociologist, and what do I as a teacher bring into my classroom. So I think at one level, what we publish, what we write, what conferences we organize, what papers we present, that goes a long way in shaping the feminist sociology that we are part of. But I think in our everyday classes, what we bring into our class and how we shape and how we get shaped by the exchanges, by the syllabus, by the examples, by the reading material, by the discussions, by the fights that we have in the classroom, that goes also to a very long extent into shaping of the feminist sociology that I kind of very much believe in. And I think I can very well see, like looking at Manisha, these photographs, that the sociology, feminist sociology, doesn't get made in the classroom. It gets made in the informal conversations, while having coffee, while having, you know, discussions over emails, over chit chats. Now we have WhatsApp. So I think this is where one has to channelize. And I think, there's a lot everybody has said with regard to the legacy of Sharmila, but for me, I think she is an inspiration with, as Manisha Di also said, with all her humanly faults. Every one of us, I think, wanted to be liked by her. And it was always just to be accepted by her. But I think each one of us had our own journeys, and each one had our own memory of Sharmila, which for each one of us was very, very important. But I think legacies are made not in terms of one book, one idea, but in terms of the different ways in which one related to that person. Yeah. So I think for me, the book, the articles, and the work that I'm doing now with regard to and continuing with the way in which I understand pedagogy and make it a much, much more understanding in the way one frames feminist sociology, is how I understand and how I remember Sharmila. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah, that's all I have to say.
Anurekha Chari, for bringing it the day-to-day lived experiences, and how Sharmila Rege, as a teacher, as a mentor, had established rapport with her students, and also the question of power that you brought out in the process of mentoring, demand of loyalty and the camps and all. Yeah, it's very, very painful, but I think that's the reality with the feminist sociologists are facing. Now I would like to request Dr. Pushpesh Kumar, who is also a contributor of this book. Can you unmute yourself and speak, Dr. Pushpesh Kumar?
Pushpesh?
Please unmute yours. You are unmuted. Can we see you?
Try speaking something.
Yeah. Can you put your video on?
Yes, we can see.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. And this is again a last minute push, as Manisa has said. And I'm also going to sort it out with Gita.
Nudge, not push.
Tomorrow, but some other time. Right. But thank you, everyone. And thank you, Gita, for asking me to shed some light on it, how I got associated. And I feel that both Professor Ganesh and Professor Rege, in some way academically, I feel associated, because my original PhD work is on kinship, and I borrowed a lot from Professor Kamala Ganesh. And I could learn a lot reading her work and engaging with her work. And Patricia was my mentor, supervisor, and she always encouraged me that you should look at Kamala Ganesh's work. And even when I was talking to Rajni was also referring to that you should read her work, kind of a thing. So I'm very familiar with Professor Ganesh's work. And I must say that I have learned a lot on kinship and gender, reading and engaging with her work. To Sharmila Rege, when I was in a provincial university in Nanded, I was teaching where there was no library, no infrastructure, no computer even when I joined. And then I wrote an article for Sociological Bulletin, which was on gender and resistance. And I still preserve her handwritten reviewer's note, which the bulletin sent to us. And later on, Sharmila told me that I was the reviewer when it got published of your article. And the wonderful things she wrote as a young scholar at that time, having no publication at all. This was my first publication in an academic journal. And I'm so happy, and sometimes I get very sentimental when I look at that that note which she wrote, handwritten note as a reviewer. In those days, we had not technologically advanced that much at that time, and it came through a registered post, And I didn't know who this reviewer is, because it's a blind review. And when Sharmila revealed much later that it is she who has reviewed this article, and I feel so felt so honored and so associated. And then one of my students' dissertation in Marathi, it went to Sharmila, but then I personally talked to her that if you can do a bit of faster, then she did it. And she said, then I said her that, this is a thesis in Marathi from Nanded. It may not be up to your expectation. Then she said in a very friendly manner, "Are hum jante hai na, how we have also done our MPhil." Now these are some of the anecdotes and moments. And then she invited me to the center to speak and all. And I feel very, very sentimental. And sometimes it's really hard to digest to know that Sharmila is no more with us. And also her book, Writing Caste, Writing Gender, and Against the Madness of Manu, I have used in a piece, and also her work on Lavni. I'm going to now write a piece on Lavni. To carry forward her legacy, and Anagha is already doing it. So in this way, I feel associated with both of their work. So in this volume, when Gita sort of invited me to sort of be a part of this seminar, and I was very thrilled. And then I wrote something, an abstract on kinship. But suddenly I realized that kinship and gender people have been talking about, but there's something else which needs to be talking about within the feminist discourse. And even we need to talk about alternative kinship and how it is emerging among marginalized gender non-conforming groups and all. So I thought, that feminist sociologists are talking about deconstructing gender. But then they stuck onto a binary of male and female. And hardly anyone who is going beyond this binary of men and women. So I wanted to foreground this in my work, in my this particular presentation. And I have been engaged with the lives of Kothi men in smaller cities in Western India, Maharashtra. So I just based on Siddhite males who talked about, you know, personal troubles and public issues as public issues. And also Michael Budaway, who talks about expanding the horizons of sociology by incorporating and including new subjects and new subjectivities. So I thought of talking about marginal gender non-conforming persons from lower caste class background particularly. And here it reminds me of Sharmila Rege's work on caste and gender. So I thought, you know, even sometimes, you know, the women among Dalits are exploited both within the community as well as outside the community. And that has been theorized within sociology and within other disciplines. But what was happening that these men are exploited by all, but even community will disown them, right? So I have talked elsewhere that they are faggots. You know, if you translate into English, it is faggots. Who talks about faggots, Dalit faggots, by the Dalit community themselves? Because the one thing is that Dalit women, it is on the Dalit women's body that community produces itself, but they are non-reproducing bodies. Even if they think, imagine themselves as women, but they are non-reproducing bodies. The community cannot produce itself on the basis of the bodies of the Kothis, even if they claim as women. So if the community is de-authenticating them as women, if state is still, because we have the law, the transgender law 2019, again, if they don't undergo a surgery of SRS, they are and get a certificate, right, of that, they can only claim they are women. Otherwise, they are not. So they are even de-authenticated. So why feminist studies, feminist sociology should also participate in this de-authentication? They are the one who contest, challenge the binary norms of gender and patriarchy, right? In some way, we as feminists also reproduce patriarchy unconsciously in certain ways if we stuck onto the binary of male and female. So I thought of talking about their lives, who face a lot of public violence and a lot of domestic violence, and how they negotiate their lives in every day. So that's why I have used pink money, because all their money, they work as office boys or some other petty jobs where they get 5,000, 6,000 rupees a month. And that all money is being taken and appropriated by the familial household. And that's why they are allowed to remain within the household, Dalit households or any other social groups household. So what they do sex work, or they call dhandha in the night, and they earn this money and put in a separate account which the family doesn't know. And this is their pink money, through which they manage their everyday life. They meet different kinds of expenses and all. So I think they are the ally in feminist politics of social change and transformation, because they are the one, if we incorporate their perspective, they definitely challenge, crisscross this male-female binary and raise a lot of question on this binary construct of gender and patriarchy. If you use Butler, they're mocking the naturality of gender. So why feminist sociologists are not talking about such subjectivities, who directly raise lots of question mark on binary gender and patriarchy? So I think this is what I tried to write about the life. This is one facet of the gender non-conforming life. There are many others that are coming up now. And even if we have a lot of literature, some of the literature available, like Maya Sharma's work on being lesbian in underprivileged India, which is so sociological. So she has come up with another book, you know, recently, I forgot the title of it. These are not, she's not from sociology, but her work is so sociological. And we never imagine, we never try to incorporate all of that. So definitely feminist sociology in certain ways has to own that guilt, right? And I'm making them feel guilty also through my writings. So that is such a significant perspective, such a significant viewpoint, and then these men are claiming themselves as women, and everyone is denying them as women. And we as sociologists have to engage with that. And, you know, people have to move beyond my work also. It's not a final word, right? So with this, I'll stop. And thank you again, Professor Patel and everyone, and IMPRI and Gita and Joseph, yeah, for giving me this support.
Thank you, Professor Pushkesh Kumar, for expanding our horizon of sensitivity and sensibility by bringing up the issue of marginalized gender kothis, and also how they negotiate their life through the prism of caste, class, and gender. Very, very important dimension, and I'm sure all of us are guilty. I think everyone is feeling guilty, and I think this guilt should translate itself into transformatory process. That's very important. Now, there is a question by Dr. Ritambara Hebbar. Would you like to unmute yourself and speak, Dr. Ritambara Hebbar?
She has left, Vibhuti Ben.
So I can read it. She asked that one of the ways of reimagining sociology to strengthen feminist perspectives is to also engage with disciplines like economics and political science for the way these disciplines relate to women's issues, their methodologies, and substantive scholarship it has produced in recent times. I would like to know panelists' views on this. I think it's a very, very important thing. We can take it up on 26th in the second discussion. But still, I think now it's your turn, Dr. Gita Chadha and Dr. Joseph, to answer all the views that have been expressed also in the chat box, as well as by the panelists. Yeah. Over to Dr. Gita Chadha and Dr. Joseph.
So I think we've spent almost an hour and a half now, and maybe on the 26th also we can take some of these questions. But just a quick thank you to Manisha and Pushpesh for getting nudged. But just a quick response to some. I've been responding in the chat also on this question of, are we really, and we address this in the book also, are we really interested in making legacies? Because one of the reviewers of the book said, oh, but you know, this is not really a legacy. What is, I mean, there's nothing to it, you know. And that made me think considerably on this question of legacy. And I revisited Professor Dhanagare's understanding of schools and how schools emerge. I'll go into it probably the next time, but it suffices to say today that, are we really wanting to make a legacy? Because I find the notion of legacy deeply patriarchal. And I think it is a question of making collectives, feminist collectives. And that's the word actually Anagha used in the beginning. So I think that's absolutely something that I wanted to flag off. On the question that Professor Sanjay Srivastava raised, which is, what can men in sociology do? And this is a persistent question as to what men in sociology, how do they relate to feminism? So the way Pushpesh answered it, I found was very interesting, because as Victor Seidler, a lot of masculinity scholars said that feminism actually made men feel very guilty, and out of that guilt came a lot of self-examination. And I think now it's also important for us as feminists to expand our canvas and to bring in challenges and questions so that we become, you know, address complexity of social realities in a significant manner. So I think, but I would only like to say that I think it's important for masculinity studies to enter into the sociology of gender, simply because it is important to look at the gender ideology and the gender regime from the point of view of men, and how men get constituted, and how men have a problem perhaps with that kind of gender ideology. But as Sanjay said, it's an important thing to get rid of that. You also have to get rid of the power. Whereas Pushpesh is talking about the kind of masculinity which is already marginalized. And so how do we bring, so Vishal's article in the book, for example, is about the hypermasculine, the, you know, construction of the hypermasculine. And Pushpesh is talking about an alternative marginalized masculinity. So I think it's important for us to look at masculinity within the sociology of gender, using the kind of history and critical apparatus that feminism has already provided us. I would say to Sanjay's question also, and what Pushpesh actually says in the introduction of his article, that I work as an ally you know, of feminism. While it's important for me to question and challenge and make guilt, it's also important for me to work as an ally. So I think what is the nature of being an ally, what is ally politics, is an open question in today's kind of epistemically fragmented worlds. But I think that's really what I'd like to say. And because of time, I'll sort of let it be here, and maybe Joseph.
Yeah, thanks, Gita. Yeah, thanks once more, IMPRI and Professor Patel and all the organizers. And thanks also for our colleagues who came out, especially Manisha and Anurekha and Pushpesh and Rukmini Sen, giving contributions from their perspective, and Manisha's lovely photographs down memory lane. Thanks very much for it. I think this session brought focus on the books. An agenda which was pluralizing genders, pluralizing feminisms, and pluralizing sociologies, and finding interconnections. And that is something that Professor Sanjay Srivastava actually also focused on. And taking that forward, something that he also talked about is narratives, autobiographies. And in the book, there are pieces, especially by Rennie and others, who also talk about narratives and their importance in sociology, which is again something that we take off from Sharmila's work, especially writing caste, writing gender, and her beautiful, intellectually stimulating introduction to that work on the testimonial as a category, which we all have profited a lot from that kind of an interpretation that she has given. So this one particular phrase that I take from today's interaction is the way that Anagha and Gita actually talked about collectives rather than legacies. I think we need to, when we talk about legacies, we need to correct ourselves a bit. This is something that I would take home from today's session. There is something one of our ex-students, Rubina, has kept a questionnaire. Gita has answered it. It's about preferred use of preferred pronouns of students, especially in online classes these days. And that's very, very important kind of a query that she has raised, obviously. Thanks.
That can be taken up in the next session when Dr. Kamala Ganesh is there.
Thank you, guys.
So I think today's discussion, everyone is spellbound, and it has created very much intellectually vibrant atmosphere and also very electrifying influence it has had. It has given a massive food for thought. And I would like to conclude by thanking Dr. Gita Chadha, Dr. Joseph M.T., Dr. Sanjay Srivastava, Dr. Anagha Tambe, Dr. Smita Patil, Dr. Who could not join, but she had all the willingness to join, Dr. Anurekha Chari, Professor Rukmini Sen, Dr. Manisha Rao, for enriching session and a brilliant exposition to feminist sociology, contribution of feminist foremothers, feminist pedagogies, and mentoring processes that facilitated substantive transformation, and contributions of also special focus on Professor Sharmila Rege's contribution in mainstreaming caste, class, and gender discourse. Thank you, the esteemed participants and panelists. I can see sociologists from all over India. I think I can name and Dr. Vishwapriya from Kashmir University, Jammu University is there. Dr. Ritambara from TIS is there, and I can see many more teachers, scholars, and students, and even the feminist activists are part of this today's session. There are in all the platforms. This is Zoom platform, but even on Facebook Live and YouTube, more than 250 people have registered. I would like to end with the verses that Dr. Sharmila Rege penned with her colleagues, and many of my students, they enacted this in a several public, in the cultural programs and education fair. And this is these verses were written by Dr. Sharmila Rege in collaboration with Dr. Sneha Gole and Sujita Roy. And it was a feminist collaborative on declining sex ratio. And it goes like this. You people, we are singing song. I think all of you remember the collaborative tune, no? Hard-hitting song, hit hard song. Why this collaborative? Why this collaborative? Message correct. Why this collaborative? Sex ratio up, please. Why this collaborative? Huh? The boy on the moon, the girl out of sight, you, everywhere Baba, stop the killing, let girls leave. Slogans will not work. Change structures, come together. Ratio will change gear. Sathi, oh my Sathi, show me how. Show how. Why now ratio should change? How, you friend? No girl is dying now. She's happy. Wow. This song for girls and boys. We have a choice. Why this collaborative? Yes, Sharmila, we have a choice to strive for gender's transformative pathway. Thank you, everybody. Over to IMPRI team.
Ma'am, should we go also for 1 minute to Professor Sanjay and Dr. Anagha, ma'am?
Yeah. Okay, yeah.
Professor also would like to have any comments?
I enjoy being here, and I think it's very nice that the conversation is being widened, as Gita mentioned, in terms of thinking about masculinity studies of a particular kind and what's its relationship with feminism should be. I think it should always be an uncomfortable relationship, which is why and men should say that they are feminists, but not too often. I really enjoyed the discussion. I think, yeah, it was great. Thank you for including me.
Dr. Tambe?
I mean, everything has already been discussed, but just to take up from where maybe Professor Sanjay Srivastava also ended, that as Gita also mentioned, that this standpoint and epistemic positions has been something that has been discussed also in feminism now, in women's studies and feminist studies now. And therefore, if feminists and Sharmila in her Dalit feminist standpoint does say that she is a Dalit feminist, and therefore I think then men can definitely be feminists. That's where I would end. Thank you.
Thank you. So Karnika, over to you.
As we have come to the end of this extremely enlightening discussion, I, Karnika, researcher at IMPRI, Impact and Policy Research Institute, New Delhi, would like to formally propose the vote of thanks. On behalf of IMPRI Gender Impact Study Center, we are grateful to Professor Vibhuti Patel for chairing and leading the book discussion on Reimagining Sociology in India, Feminist Perspectives. We thank the editors, Professor Dr. Gita Chadha and Dr. Joseph M.T. for sharing your views. We would also like to thank the panelists, Dr. Anagha Tambe, Professor Sanjay Srivastava, and Dr. Smita Patel, for adding your diverse perspectives and valuable insights to the deliberation. And of course, we would like to thank all our participants here on Zoom or on Facebook Live for participating and raising pertinent questions. We are grateful if you're watching us later on YouTube or listening us on various of our podcasts. I hope that you continue to tune into our future Gender Gap series and IMPRI hashtag web policy talks. Thank you once again, and I wish you all a very good evening.
May please also join us for the IMPRI session on 26th by Professor Kamala Ganesh, and the panelists are also there. We can take up some of this issue further in a detailed discussion. Yeah. It is from 4 to 5:30.
Thank you.